First of all, thank you for the organizer inviting me for here to give the talk. And it's always been good coming back home. I'm originally from Hong Kong, so I've been away for many years. And then it's always good to come to see old friends. Okay, so today, the talk that I'm going to talk about is seeing, is believing, right? And well, earlier you hear the talk about speech. We come here and we talk about images. And I need to give the credit to my three former PhD students. Most of the work are done by them. And so they're all graduates. Here is NTU, the building at our university, the latest building. Okay, so interestingly, for 150 years, majority of the students in the United States, you know, in the classroom, or in the school, they see this picture, right? But how many of them know that? There's another photo, the rest much similar, except the face. So this happened, it's a Southern politician, happened. This picture happened to have find it earlier than President Lincoln's picture. So what happened was, this is a doctored photo. All right, so because for some reason they cannot find a better photo to show a hierarchic portrait of the president, so they use this one. So for 150 years, right? Well, what about this one here? Here you see this was the prime minister in Canada, Queen Elizabeth and King George, right? And at that time, this photo somehow, when he went for elections, and then he removed King George from picture to show that he is very close to Queen Elizabeth, right? So show him is more powerful. So that's what happened, right? Now, if we look at some more famous photos, right? For example, in Lebanon War, Reuters 2006, doctored smoke here, and Kelly and Fonda, if you don't know, Jane Fonda is against anti-war, against Vietnam. And John Kerry at that time was running for president. Suddenly this photo came out, but they were never together, okay? So they're trying to show, you know, I mean, Kelly is against war and, you know. And this is another very interesting that appear in the Saturday night, right? And they are talking about this monster cat, Snowball. So they discuss about all this, you know, wow, this is really a big cat, you know, and then in white, and then there's a topic. And after 2 years, the owner came out and said, wow, actually this is a photo shopped picture. So they make the cat big. Actually, it's not true, right? So we have a lot more of those things. For example, here, you see the pyramid, but in any part in Egypt, you cannot find an angle such that you have these two pyramids together. This is another very interesting one. Well, you know, this is found out in FBI reward of justice websites, right, in 2009. So somebody was trying to figure out how he looked after certain years, right? They did a picture, they took a picture of this guy and did a morphing and now with this picture, right? Saying that, oh, okay, this is a most wanted terrorist, Osama. But he find it out. So this is he is the member of parliament in Spain and find out, wow, actually that was my picture, right? So this is all doctored photos and there's some more fun pictures, right? You know that Sarah Palin and Obama, you know, one is Democrat, one is Republican, right? They never dance together. So there's some funny pictures. But if you really look at these pictures, you see them. If you don't know the story behind it, you believe them, right? That is the problem these days. I give you examples, right? When I came here and I read the newspaper and they're talking about the seven cops, you know, beating up a civic party member. And then now the judge was talking about, wow, we have all this video clip, all this image. Are they real or not? Right? So there's a debate on this now. So in the real world, we see a lot of video cameras, right? Video surveillance cameras. So the question here is, well, are these couple here or not, right? So we are facing all these problems these days to tell if a picture is true or video clips is true. So what this leads us to, so people look at image forensic problem. So very often, we're talking about alternating existing images. For example, deal with removal or adding of objects, right? Spicing, enhancement, you do a retouching of a photo, morphing, I just show you, cropping an image, also a false captioning. Another interesting thing is even the computer graphics. These days, a computer can generate an object which is so real that human cannot tell the difference. Also, scenery forgeries, you know, your friends say, oh, I've been to Fuji Mountain, you know, at the back is just a poster, in the front you take a picture, and then you send to your friend, right? So it happened all the time, right? So what's the truth? So now, even government, they're doing it, right? For example, here in the Israeli cabinet photos, you can find in the Huntington Post, right? You can see her. This is original, and there are two politicians, but when they put on a website, they remove them, all right? In India, there's a newspaper reporting a tsunami. They couldn't find a picture. They went and got this picture. Actually, this picture was something happened in Qiantangjiang in China. And they put it and put a caption, wow, look, there's tsunami here. Okay, so that's a false captioning problem. Here's another one. It's a bloody river because there was a terrorist in Luxor, Egypt. So in the Swiss tabloid, right, they used this original photo. They make it red bloody. So as if, you know, it was, very serious things, right? So again, even when you read newspaper, you may be reading something that is not actually the truth. A famous story in LA Times, and this reporter is an award-winning guy, right? And then, you see, in LA Times, you read all the photos, right? Actually, he did something, you know, he combined these two photos and generated this one and published this one. So he was fired because as a reporter, you have to tell the truth. You know, you cannot just tamper the pictures, right? What about cloppings, right? Interesting. If you're shown in this picture, you see a Iraqi soldier, and you see a Marine, US Marine. You look at this picture, right? You have your own interpretations, right? If you look at this picture, you have another type of interpretations. But what happened? This is the original. So you can see cropping can tell the differences. Just like speech also, you know. If you take away part of it, you can mean totally different things. Well, if you are from China, I'm sure you remember this case, right? So somebody, you know, that's called a South China Tiger. So somebody had a picture, a cardboard of this South China Tiger and put it in the brochure. And took a picture of it and said, okay, I find this one, I want to get funding and I want to do something about it. So at that time, they did not know if there was really a tiger there or not, right? So this is like a mixture of the real scene and also the photo, right? Now increasingly, color changes. Is it at dawn or in the morning or in the evening? Which one? What about I change the color also, you know, tell my friend that instead of red, I have a yellow car, okay? If you look at it, you can't tell the difference. So, how do we deal with this? Can we tell if a picture is real or tempered? One easy way is if you put some, what we call, adding some information there, we can call it watermark, right? So, when you extract a watermark, if it's nothing, it's still the original, you know that it's original photo. Right, but the problem here is that you know, basically who wants to add noise into a nice photos, isn't it? So, and also you have some kind of handshaking, you know about the key management. So that is the problem by using active forensic, by adding watermark, right? We here are talking about passive approach. I do nothing about the photo, and can I tell if this is a real or a fake one? That's what we are trying to do here. So some of you may not know, I mean, if you use a camera, you have a scenery, go through the filtering, then you have a color filter array, right? So the sensor at the back can sense only one color. So you have either red, green, or blue. And then with that, they can do some kind of a demosaicing to generate the color photo. And in addition, they may be doing this kind of gamma correction, right? Balancing, all these things, you get a photo, right? So that's what you have. So with this photo, that generated a lot of interesting research work. One thing is that source identification. Can I tell where this photo come from? Which camera, right? Tampering discovery. Is there any part of the photo is being tampered? Is anything being hidden in the photo? Can I recover the processing history? So how this photo is being generated? Can I tell it's a computer graphic, natural, or retaken photo, right? A retaken photo, like you capture from the screen, right? Device temporal forensic, also, what about spoofing issues, right? How do we use photo to fool people, right? Okay, so the work's done. For example, individual device identification, one of the things that being used with what you call photo response non-uniformity, sensor noise pattern. You can think of any hardware, anything. When you touch a sensor, you always have a certain noise pattern. That's the unique signature for that camera. If you find the noise pattern, you'll be able to identify the camera, right? So if I do not have the camera, all right, can I do a source model identifications? One of the things is that if you are a camera manufacturer, right, you build a camera, you have different model. For the same model, most likely you have the same chip with the same demosaicing process. So we can look the processing regularity. Do they use the same processing or different, right? We can also talk about quality of the sensor, right? You also can talk about, you know, image regularities, right? The natural image statistics. We can talk about that later. Now, tampering discovery, we talk about the sensor noise patterns, non-source identification. We can talk about light direction, okay, tampering anomalies, right? For example, night directions. You know, a photo, if only have one light source, you can see a lot of reflections, right? You see the direction of reflection or even the shadow, all these things being discussed in some paper. Detection of unconventional images, right? We're talking about recapturing, so we also have a researcher working on it. Now, if you look at the history, these are some of the past work that done by people. Region duplications. Obviously, when you remove an object, you have to cover it up, right? So you duplicate a part of the regions, right? Resampling, you do a rotation and scaling, can you tell? Splicing, right, this work are done by these people. And double JPEG compressions, because of a lot of photo nowadays are JPEG format. So can we make use of those information to find if a photo has been tampered or not? We have more, right? We have scenes regularities, right? We also have optical regularity of a lens system, for example, chromatic aberrations. What we are talking about is that if you use a camera to take a photo, we all know that right at the center of the photo has the least distortion because you have a different light source, the light source of different, you know, red, green, and red, blue, right? So the moment you crop it, you are moving the center, right? Basically, it's no longer at the center of the photo anymore when you crop it. So this is some, you know, trace that you can find if someone has crop the photo, right? Sensor imperfections, We'll talk about that. Processing regularity, these are the work done by other people. And this one, statistical regularity, for example, image quality, right? You can imagine if the photo is original, the quality is A quality. If you cut and paste part of it, that region may not be quality A, it may be quality B, right? So you will be able to tell why there's a difference, right? So if you look at the light source, right, this Ferris group's done this before, so it's straightforward. Think of it as two eyeballs, right? I mean, a certain light source coming in, so you can see the reflection in these directions, right? So it's straightforward. But the challenge here is that if you look at this, the challenge is this. If you look at the occluding surface region, it's very hard to look at the portion that it has light reflections. It's number one. Number two is that they may not have light source, certain direction of light source. So this one, for certain photo, you may be able to do that. For majority of it, it's very difficult. Now, the sensor noise in the camera, basically, we're talking of different type of noise. The one that the researcher focusing on is the PRNU. How does it work? Well, first of all, Kurosawa in 2002 find out that every single camera, right, you have the CMOS sensor there. They have a certain unique noise pattern. They have certain unique noise pattern. Then he stopped there. Now, this group, Fritsch, make use of that information. Basically, what they do is, okay, if I have a camera, and I have a camera, I will take N images, right? If I go through this wavelet-based denoising filter, and then I subtract it off from the original, I get the residues, right? And then you have the test image. You want to find out if this image comes from the same camera. You do the same thing, you just compare the noise pattern, then you know it's coming from the same camera or not, right? So is it really practical? Have they done this? Well, I was told that in US court, there's a case, there's a kidnapper who kidnapped somebody and then sent the photo to the victim's parents and asked for a ransom. So after a while, the police capture the kidnapper and then they find the camera, they didn't find the photo. So what did they do? They did exactly what's done here. The technical people did all this and figure out that indeed the photo that they sent to the parents, victim's parents, came from the camera that they got from the kidnapper's home. So this was being used as evidence in the court. Okay. Now, we're talking about, for that particular case, you have the camera. You have the camera. You want to see if that photo coming from that camera or not. What if you do not have the camera? Okay? So what we're talking about is talking about, we're not identify original camera, we're talking about identify the model of the camera. So how do we do it? Well, first of all, we know that, right? We have this raw photo, and then from raw photo to a demosaicing, you get a colorful one, right? Basically, we are talking about the raw are the RGB, right? These are the missing colors are the estimated missing color channels, right? Estimated. So in each pixel, you have three colors, so you only know one is the raw, but you don't know which one. You have no idea, right? So that's one thing. We're talking about the Bayer CFA patterns, right? So, but we know that, for example, right, this is the blue. We're missing the green color. So one of the easier way, maybe we just add this together, right? Take an average, right? Find the neighboring one, you estimate the green missing one. Here, diagonally, and this vertical, there's horizontal, right? So there are only limited way to do that. So that's one thing we know. So there's a combination of this, right? The second thing is that, well, if we talk about the missing green colors, right? So you want to find the missing estimate, the green color here. One thing for sure is that whatever you get here, you want to have the least changes in the neighboring, right? So you can look at the derivatives, right? The least change, you want it to be more smooth, right? So that's another one. So the third thing is that, well, if you are you're missing the green color here, right? Say, suppose you estimate the green color. So one of the way is you just do a weighted sum, right? You find a weighted sum of neighboring colors. So the weightage, okay, for your demosaicing process would be the feature of that particular model of the camera that being used, right? So that feature, you'll be able to use it to identify which color, which model of the camera is being used, right? So we can do that. Another thing is, okay, so how do I minimize when I find it? How do I minimize which pattern is it, right? So this is what this expectation maximization is doing. So I'll give you an example here. So we generate this color image from a raw image, making use of the Hamilton algorithm, which is a demosaicing process. So this is the CFA patterns being used. This is ground truth of the wave pattern. This is something you know, because you generate something you know, right? We use our algo to estimate this weight. So it turned out that, okay, in this pattern, we get this way. In this pattern, right, you see the R here, the red here, the red is this pattern, the red is here. There's four different possibilities, right? So we have four sets. And you compare with the ground truth, you find out that this is closest. Indeed, this is the pattern, right? So it works. So the technique works. You can find out the pattern based on that. So what do we do? Okay, so if it works, then we try to test it out. So we use 16 different demosaicing algos here. Some are commercial, some are from paper, right? The most common one. So we try this out to see if it works or not, right? So we use this 16 different algo, generate different type of photos, okay? So we know the ground truth, so we plot it. So we look at, okay, what's missing is the green color. Say, when we estimate the green color, so we have 16 different methods, right? And then we have each method, we have 100 photos that we are looking at. And we look at the error, and it turned out that ours, you can see a proposed one, has the lowest, the mean error. So it's like 0.5 range, right? 0.5% range, so it's very close. So that means, again, you know, whichever algo you use, we can match it, right? So if that works, that means given a photo, if we can find the feature that I just mentioned, once you get the feature, you can do the classification, right? You can classify which algo is being used. Okay. So we try out. So what we do is we have 1,000 images with 600 training and 40 testing images, right? So what we do is we look at post-demosaicing process, meaning that after the demosaicing, you can do white balancing, you know, gamma correction, all these things, right? And then for each one, we're looking at the 200 features, 24 features, and the other techniques, right? And we will look at the accuracy performance. How close can they classify the 16 demosaicing methods that I just showed it to you? And then you can see that, right? This first method with 200 features, if you draw a line here, is basically about 90%. Okay, even with other type of post-processing. So it works very well. We use a probabilistic SVM to do that. Now, if you look at, if we do a JPEG compression, you know that the moment you do a JPEG compression, you lose some information, right? You drop some information. What happened is that if the Q factor goes all the way to 80, say for example 80, we still achieve about 80%. So if you go further down with Q factor, obviously the performance won't be so good, right? So it's understand. Okay, sorry. All right, so can we use this for camera identifications, right? We're talking about camera identification. So we did that. We have 2,800 JPEG photos from 14 different cameras. So each photo we cut into 12 blocks for testing. So these are the samples of the photos that we're doing. And then these are the camera, 14 different cameras, right? We do. And this is the confusion matrix. This is a camera one, Canon. Can we identify as Canon? 96%. This one is Canon power shot. Can we do that? 90%. So this is our result, right? So you can see on average, we get 97.5%, making use of sequential forward floating search feature to do that. So the accuracy is quite high that we can identify which camera being used for those photos, right? What happened to the 2.5% error? What happened? So we zoom it in and look at those image block. These are the one image block. You see, 50% are like that. They're too dark or too bright, and they are like a saturated one, which is fine. I mean, we expect it, right? What kind of demosaicing when there's only one color, right? So everything, every child is the same color. You can't tell. So, but this is not an interest region anyway, right? Because there's nothing there. So it works well. We also see, okay, so we are talking about 200 features, right? Can we lower it down? So we make use of one of our earlier work. We call that ERE, right? Eigenfeature Recognition Extractions. And we apply that for face recognition. Well, so we apply it here. So see how it is. Okay, look, we reduce it from 200 to 20 features, right? And then you can see the performance actually is slight improvement also, right? So this is the outcome. So it's worked well. Now, we're talking about camera identification for 16 camera, it works well. What if we want to find out what software is being used to produce the color images, right? We try that out. We use some common software tools. You can see here, the color photo are not exactly the same. So can we tell which one is being used? Well, it works well too. So we try 10 different software box to do that. It's running out of battery. Wow, this is really fast. Okay, so you can see, right? You can see here, the 10 different approaches, we can achieve about 99% accuracies, right? Using 50 selected features. Again, it works very well for this particular case. We also apply the ERE techniques for this particular problem. And then you can see that with a 20 eigenfeature, we achieve 99.7% for this case. So it's very accurate. If you are talking about demosaicing, right? Okay, so we said, okay, why don't we look at the mobile cameras also? Because mobile cameras, you know, took a lot of pictures, right? So we tried the mobile cameras. This is a list of mobile cameras. We use this sample of the picture that we look at. So we try this out, and this is the outcome. Now here, the Nokia, these are all different model camera. This is the same model, different camera, same model, different camera. So you can see different model work perfectly. Same model, different camera, we can expect that the performance is not as good because we are not here to identify exactly which camera. Remember, the previous approach talking about noise pattern, you can do it. But in this case, we can only identify the model of the camera. So, it's so straightforward that, okay, if we can identify what the demosaicing approach being used, well, we can always use that to detect the tampering. Right, we can always do that. So that's what we do, right? You see, if you have an image with n representative sources, you have n different sources, n different type of models, right? You extract the demosaicing features, that's what we did. You do a classification, you get the classifier. So a test photo coming in, you do the exact thing, so you have the classifier. You can use any classifier, and then you can find a probability map for each block to see if there's any problem with it or not, okay? So why will we have problem? Well, let's look at this case, very simple case here. So we break this photo into four regions. The first one, we didn't do anything. This one, we shift one pixel to the right. This one, shift one pixel bottom. This one, shift one pixel diagonally. So we have this tempered photo. Look at these two, nobody knows there's anything wrong with it. right? But if you look at the ground truth, you know that this is a one pixel shift. You know even one pixel shift, you're shifting the pixel location already, right? So it's no longer the original. So indeed, we apply our approach, that's what we find. This is a probability map. The darker region meaning that there's something wrong with them. So you compare these two, so you know where are the problems, right? The region that has problem. We do this for another one. We spice these two together, that this one. This is the ground truth. This part not supposed to be there. And the detection result is like this. Same for this one. These are not supposed to be there. And then this is the result. You compare these two, the ground truth. Again, you are able to detect the region that has problem. Okay. So what I just showed to you is about demosaicing, right? Let's change something else. So suppose, I'll tell you why it's not always work just for demosaicing. Why? For example, if somebody did that and take a picture from the screen using another camera, then if you use demosaicing, it won't work, right? Because I have a new photo using a new camera. So that one won't work. Okay, now let's look at another scenario. Tampering detection based on JPEG compressions. You see, when you do a compression, right, JPEG, you have this artifact of quantizations, right? Before compression, after compression, because of quantization process going through, or blocking artifacts, right? You can see there's a blocking artifact. So you know there's some information there. So what researchers do is, okay, if I have one photo without any JPEG compression, and then I take part of the region from a photo with one JPEG compression, I cut and paste into it, that's a trace already, because you have two different compression in one photo, right? So that's what Farris group did. You can see that this original, and he put the car here, and then these two have a different compression, and then you can see in this photo, you can detect that is not supposed to be there. Okay, so this is basically based on that. So more work recently done by another group here, you can see that they are looking at the JPEG compression here, the pyramid not supposed to be there. But the limitation is that it's difficult to separate single from double compression when quality factor of second compression is smaller than the first one. Because if you do that, you don't see the artifacts there anymore. Okay, so keep in mind on that. So that is JPEG compressions. And then we look at another interesting problem. Say, okay, what if we just change the brightness, right? If you look at the photo, I change the brightness, it's just adjusting the DC values, isn't it? So for example, right here, I change the brightness, right? Do you know which one is original? Wow, we tried, most of the technique won't work at all because that is a very hard problem. So we thought, okay, can't we make use of the EXIF, right? You know that the photo, usually they have something called EXIF, right? In this case, A, B, C, D, E, F. If I ask you which one is real, most of you can't tell which one is the original, right? So we look at the EXIF, for example, EXIF camera, there's a setting, right? ISO speed, exposure time, F number, and so forth, right? So can we, okay, make use of this information, right? How do we make use of this information? Well, let's look at this example here. If this is the original, you have black and white, right? And use the camera B, right? You're setting ISO 800, C ISO 3200. You're setting different ISO. You look at the image that you get, it's different. There's noise there. So what it means is that the noise actually can be correlated with the EXIF parameter. This parameter, what I just showed to you, right? This parameter. So can we do something about it? Right? If we can relay the noise with the EXIF parameter, that means the moment part of the image are being altered, being replaced, right? The noise correlation with the original EXIF parameter will be different. So you can tell either that part has been changed or the EXIF parameter has been changed, isn't it? So that's what we did. So we did that. So how do we do it, right? So for example, you have the training images. So you extract the image noise feature, and then you extract the EXIF header features, right? You have these two. And then you can, we can use this kind of regression way to find out you know, the relationship. But how we how do we have this idea? Because we read a paper talking about photon transfer curve. It turned out that there are certain relationship, kind of linear type relationship with the noise in a photo, and so based on that we have this idea, right? So we have the regression weight. So if you have a test image, you extract the noise feature, you have the EXIF parameters, right? You know that with this one, if you use this one to generate, you can compare this one and this one, you get the new EXIF parameter. You can compare this new EXIF parameter with the one that you extract. Are they close enough or not? If they are not, whoa, something is wrong, isn't it? So that's what we do. So, right, to go through, there are some more details, right? To go through it, because of this aperture, shutter speed, all this, there's a certain relationship which I don't want to go through it. And then we can use this weighted average regression approach to do that. Let me skip all this detail. So we do that, right? We try out the experiment. So what we do, we have a data set, right, of a 1,200 JPEG image. And they come, 400 coming in three different cameras, right? Canon, Olympus, right? Two different type of Canons, right? So we have 1,200. And then we look at two things. One is the brightness, like this straight line moving up and down, or the contrast also. This curve related with contrast. We look at the brightness and we look at the contrast. If you change the brightness, if you change the contrast, can I tell that this photo has gone through that process or not? So we do that. And we do the experiment result. So you look at the brightness, right? You when you manipulate, increase the brightness, you look at the aperture, you look at the shutter, your ISO values, your ISO value, you turn out that the true positive array and true negative, these are the result, okay? These are the result, right? ISO, you combine all this together, we are talking about a combined one of 99.7%. So you look at the decrease, you have another one. You look at contrast, you have another data. So you turn out that our technique works very well, close to 100%. If you change the brightness of the photo, we can detect it, okay? If you change the contrast, there's another group doing it from Stigma, so we performance about the same. So we can achieve a very high percentage that we can tell if the photo, the brightness has been adjusted. The question here is, well, what if I don't have the original camera, I don't have the model, does it work or not? Well, we try out. What we did is, we use a Canon and Olympus to do the training to get the regression weight, right? We use the Sony photo to do the testing. And we went through the whole process again, and we still get a very high accuracy rate. You can see higher accuracy. So here we swap it, testing Olympus also, high accuracy weight. So basically, the noise being generated, how it correlated with the EXIF parameter, has less to do with the camera itself, right? So let's go back and look at this problem, right? We asked, for example, A and B. Let's look at A and B, right? So A, we look at EXIF parameter is 5. We predicted one is 5.7. Shutter speed, A, okay, is 8, right? Predicted is 8.6. ISO, EXIF is 7, we get 8.1. For B, the value is a lot more different, 13.8, 29, and also this another number. So you know right away that, okay, B is the problem, right? So B is actually the color, the brightness has been adjusted. So you do the same thing for the remaining, you will be able to tell that B, D, and F, these are all doctored photos, well, doctor meaning that it changed the brightness, it changed the contrast. So that one tells you how we link XF parameters together with the noise within the photo itself, right? The next one is another very interesting one. We are talking about what? So originally we thought these are simple things that we're looking at. What simple thing is like, well, if someone has done some modification of the photo and displayed it on a LCD screen and take a picture of it, right? So it's like what we call anti-forensic. So this sounds like a very tough problem to deal with, right? So we tried that out. So what we did was, you look at, right, this one, right? So what we are talking about, right, input image, you manipulate it, all right, then using image forensic, you can tell. What if they display it and recapture it, and then you go through that? It fell, okay? So what we did was, we blow up, we noticed that, you know, the recapture image, right? And the original, actually there are a lot of differences, you know? You can see that's a lot of difference. That means we can tell, we can use some information. So we did something, okay, first of all, we do some recapture. We use line camera, LCD combined with cameras, right? Three different cameras, we have different LCD displays. So we make sure we do everything perfectly. So we generate all those recapture image, right? Then we ask human to look at it. Well, what we do is that we tell them, okay, these are the original, these are the retaken photos, right? No constraint of time, browsing tool, whatever you use, tell me if the photo is original or recaptured, right? We ask subjects to look at it. So we have 30 people look at it. It turned out that, interesting, if a photo is retaken, most of us cannot tell is it retaken or not. It's like 50-50, flipping a coin, right? Most of them, they thought it's original, right? So that's why this side is only 20% error. So what you're talking about, human being cannot solve this problem. Is it retaken or original? So we look at some of the features. Right, we look at the LBP, multi-scale wavelet statistics, and we look at the color features. Oh, time is running out. Okay, so we look at all these things, and then it turned out that we will combine these three together, all right, use a classification problem, we only get a 0.5% equal error rate, so it works well. Now, this thing is very interesting. Why very interesting? Company approach us, they said, oh, in the future, we are talking about web bank. We are talking about using a mobile phone to access into a bank. So face is very important. Face spoofing is a big problem, right? You know, these days, you show the picture of it and then you get in, and they do a 3D printing, get into it, all kinds of things get into it. So they're very interested to solve the problem with spoofing. Spoofing is nothing but just a recapturing, right? Right, that recapturing problem. So I can tell you there's a new field people are working in this area. It's very interesting. So my time is running out, am I right? Okay, so the last few slides, I just want to say it without telling you the details. So you can also look at the sharpness of photos. So we have some work looking at the sharpness of photo, because if you can tell the sharpness of photo, you can tell the difference of the regions, right? That's number one. Number two, you can look at the motion blur and also out of focus blur, because motion blur, you may not see it. When you take a photo, your hand shakes, there's a motion blur generated. There could be out of focus blur, right? So when you cut and paste in two together, again, you can tell the differences, all right? So you can also look at the depth problem. Okay, say if I stand here or I stand there, I take a picture, then there's different to do with the depth. So again, we can use this information to find out if the photo is being tampered or not. So these works are already published, as you can look at them. Okay, sorry for the rush at the last minute. So thank you.